of Word. You, if you don't have it in you, you're not gonna be able to look up, you won't be able to survive. And that's when people turn to other kind of things.
Like Sister said, all things work together for my good for those who love God and are called according to His purpose. Mm-hmm. So if I'm at the lowest of the low, am I just, how high am I thinking that God is going to deliver me? Because the Bible says He's going to do exceedingly abundantly above all you can ask or think. So what level do we start thinking of? I mean, way down here thinking, or do I start thinking a little bit higher? Because wherever I wind up thinking, He's going past that.
That's right.
Okay, I think the scripture says,
Sister Yvonne over here whispered a good illustration, I think, from the Old Testament. She said, look at Job. That is a good illustration of someone who had everything. And he could be a contemporary person, it's a parallel. Lost it all.
Lost everything.
But then he went through a lot of misery before he regained. So sometimes, in our misery, in our deep conditions that we're in, we're able to look up. We've got to be able to look up. If we don't, then it's often fatal for us if we're not able to look up.
That's true.
Sister, I think that's a good illustration because that was the reason why Job hit rock bottom. It wasn't that God was against him specifically, but there was some defaults or defects in his life. It was in his thinking. And y'all remember he said that he was very concerned about his sons, that they had sinned against the Lord and had cursed God. Every day he was involved in that negative thought. So that was the thing. He said, the thing that I greatly feared after it actually happened. And I don't know what else he was thinking negative about, probably everything that he lost. Probably he felt like one day he would lose it all. But that was one of the things that caused Job to experience the calamities and the distress that he went through, is because of his thinking. And he was not willing to listen to God initially. His friends accused him of doing a whole lot of things that displeased God that he wasn't guilty of. But Job didn't see how speaking, he didn't understand how spiritual principles were. He didn't think that the things that were coming out of his mouth had anything to do with the situation that he was involved with. So it was very difficult for him to see how he had sinned by speaking wrong and by making the confessions that were contrary to God's word. Because that day, they weren't taught faith like we hear today. They had no idea. They thought that God, what Job said, the Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
He blamed it all on God.
He ended up accusing God for a lot of his troubles.
But it was a bet against Job.
Yeah.
I mean, the devil petitioned God to get after Job.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if we're contemporary today, we could say that our enemy is against us today.
Absolutely.
Through our jobs, through our families, through our finances, through our health.
Yes.
So, in contemporary terms, we as Christians could very well face those same scenarios. But we are.
The difference, though. And that's a good point about that. But you said Job was challenged. Is that what you said?
No, it was a bet on Job.
It was a bet on
between Satan on and God.
But who would have made the difference? We knew what God stood.
Job. Right.
Job. But
God allowed Satan to attack him in every area except his life.
Look what Job agreed to. Job agreed to the fact that I'm in the wrong. I've done something wrong. Or his, like you said, his thinking. If Job would have been thinking correctly, talking correctly, he would have won. He would have never went through that.
But the contemporary fulfillment of it is that the enemy attacked him in all his possessions, in all his health, in his finances, his family. So if we put ourselves in today's term, the enemy is coming to steal, kill, and destroy us as well, in which we face those same scenarios. We really face those same scenarios as Job is facing. But we have the ability to speak now. Yeah, we have the ability to speak. And we know. We know.
Right. Well, the devil has the, he has the ability and he has the permission to attack us in the same way if we do not adhere to God's spiritual law.
Yeah.
See, we're not operating in God's spiritual law, operating by the law of faith, then the devil can wipe us out as well. So that's the, but Job had no idea that God had spiritual law. He didn't even know the difference between what God did and what the devil was doing.
Right.
They didn't.
Well,
how do you know the devil made it?
Well, he did.
He kept wrestling. Sometimes God was good. Sometimes God was terrible.
Yeah, he didn't know.
He just vacillated.
He didn't know.
He just vacillated between.
He had no idea what the devil was. Everything about the devil.
No, he didn't have no idea.
Wait, I didn't hear that. What was that?
He didn't know anything about the devil.
No.
He just knew that.
Something was happening.
He just felt like he did something wrong and God came against him.
He was very limited.
He had no idea that the devil was doing anything to him. He thought it was all God.
He thought it was all God. Until he would sit and meditate, and then he would say that he would come to, like he would say to his wife, no, that's not right. That's not when he would sit and meditate and get his mind right. But then again, the sickness and everything would throw him off again. And then he'd be listening to his friend's counsel again. And then sometimes it don't get in the right line.
Well, Job was he was accusing God even up to the last, because he said that, God, I just want to meet you in court.
Yeah.
I want to get this thing. I ain't done nothing wrong. I'm guiltless. And I don't know why all this stuff has came upon me. So when God made him in judgment in court, God had all these questions, 186,000.
But isn't that what we do today? You know, Lord, why is all this happening to me? You know, I'm a Christian. I go to church all the time. I do all this. I pay my tithes. I do all, you know, why has this befallen me? You do the same thing that Job did.
But that illustration is so wonderful because it's real. That's the reality of our circumstances.
You're right.
See, Job's condition did not turn around until he was willing to admit that he was in the fault and it was something that he had done to bring on all of the distress. And that's what God is looking for in many believers. And I think that is one of the primary reasons why many times believers, you know, we don't know why God withholds blessings. We don't know why we're in the situation that we're in. We don't know why the limitations are so great. We don't know, but there is usually something that preventing God from what? Releasing these mercies into our lives.
Oh, that's something we're not doing.
It's something that we're not doing, and something that we're not aware of, or something that we're not willing to what?
Make
the adjustment.
Right.
And that's the reason why they say that among believers, it's just so hard for them to receive what God has already what? Given them.
Freely.
I mean, God wants to what? Freely. But why is it that many times these blessings never get to us? So that was the point that we're trying to make. But Job finally came to the conclusion after God had what questioned him, and he couldn't respond to any, he couldn't give him any answers. Mm-hmm. So he could see how great God was and how stupid and how little he was. When he saw himself as God saw him, then the Bible says that he repented in sackcloth and ashes. And then that's when God turned the captivity of Job And that's when the blessings began to be released. Sister Irene, who's that?
You know, I was thinking about everybody was talking about. One day my husband really got vexed, and to the point where he was like, why is the God, you know, the things you ask God of, you know, it happens, and he was just really going forth. And I was like, okay, you need to calm down. But now, you know, he's not quite that bad, since, you know, God is really doing some things, he's still not smoking. So, I mean, he knows God is doing some things. But, you know, sometimes we do have to encourage each other. And like he said, things are reality. Like, but Alan was saying, some things in corporate is this and that and the other. My husband, to some people, has a fairly decent job. Mm-hmm. But it still happens there. And I mean, he's been in union where he know how they dirty and how corporate does everything to benefit them. And they cutting out all the benefits, special benefits they used to give and now they don't give. And they cutting everything they can do. And so it frustrates him. And, you know, at one point it was 7 days a week, 7 days a week. Well, he got an opportunity to take a test for an inspector. So he took it, and so he got the ins and outs before he did it. So if he didn't want to take it, if they tried to play him, he could, renege on him. And so he know he can, but they don't think he know he can. But anyway, now they want to try to give him a job 7 days a week, 12-hour shifts. And so, some people say, well, at least he got a job. Okay, that's true. But, I mean, he's already been working 7 days a week ever since we were married. But he was saying, you know, he was just getting so frustrated, and he was saying, you know, I'm just sick of them, you know, the way they do things, blah, blah, blah. And he just was going forth. And I wasn't going to do that with him. I said, you know what, you need to stop it. Because there's life and death in your tongue. And I'm not giving the devil no more room. He got all the room he needs. And I'm not helping him. So you need to stop it. Because I'm not doing it. I pray that God is going to deliver you, do what he needs to do. Because, you know, God is our source. We both know that. And whatever he do, if he has to make a special miracle for you, he'll do that. But I'm not going there with you. So you need to stop it. He shut up. Not only was I turning crazy to him, but I was speaking the word. He already got enough. I ain't giving him no more ammunition.
Well, that's what the devil gets us is when we start talking wrong.
Exactly.
Confessing wrong. And like you say, what's coming out of your mouth is going to be your reality.
That's right.
Brother Allen, I think Brother Allen had a point.
No, I don't. I was really thinking the Job story is so ideal because, I mean, as Christians, we have to understand we fight against powers, rulers, and principalities. Rulers of this dark, I mean, this world of Satan. So, I mean, what's happening to people all over the country and the world, just think about what's happening to people all over the country. I mean, to know that we're blessed simply because God is... It's not hard for us to make our needs met right now. But there are others out there that, you know, for us to say, questioning their faith on because they're not making it, when society is broken down on them in a degree, but you're right, it's what come out of our mouth.
That's right.
Or listening to God to say, well, if you got to relocate, you have to be in connection with God.
Right.
Through your spirit and being able to listen to him. But we are in a war and we do fight powers that rule
this
earth.
So, conclusion, we could say that, okay, it is what comes out of our mouth, what we speak. Because as I remember, and help me if I'm not remembering correctly, Job was a righteous man, was he not?
Perfect.
Okay,
right.
Exactly. Right. And if we are in that same situation, we're righteous. If it came up on Job, we're not exempt.
That's right.
It's how we act to what has happened to us.
We are in a much better position than Job.
Exactly. Right.
Because the same forces will try and come against
him.
But we got a little bit more on our favor than Job did. But we don't watch it. We'll submit. And be just as bad as an Old Testament believer without any knowledge. My question is, and I guess the answer is simple, our destiny, or where we go, where we wind up, who's going to determine that? I mean, I don't mean like going to heaven, but I mean like, you know, if you're going to be victorious and live that life that you want to live,
we determine
who's determining that, who's casting that final vote that makes the difference? Is it God? Is it the devil? Is it us?
It's us.
We do.
I mean, God receives that information, but we got to get put it out there.
We are the master of our fate. We are the captain of our souls. Wherever we end up is a result of the decisions and the choices that we have made.
That's a serious indictment.
And understanding that, our will, God's will for your life, because we're here to fulfill God's will for our life. So being in God's will is whether you high or whether you low, if you recognize you're in God's will, it doesn't matter.
That's true.
It doesn't matter because it's God's will that you're trying to fulfill.
Right.
That's it.
Right.
But you have to look at what the enemy is trying to do to the Christian. You know, especially the way the economy is today.
Mm-hmm.
He wants you to feel guilty and ashamed because we're prospering in this day and time. That's what the enemy wants you to do. Not God, that's what the enemy wants.
Yeah.
Wants you to feel guilty, you know, because, you know, we're prospering in this day and time, and so many people out of work, losing their home. I'm not boasting anything, but you know, with people losing jobs, you know, I quit a job. You know, it was the easiest job in the world to have, but I quit the job because God said I could, and He made a way for me to be able to do that. Now I feel bad for a lot of people, you know, because a lot of people could use that job, but it was God's will for me to let the job go because He had things for me to do. He gave me charge of my grandson, so my grandson needed me, needs me full time.
Sure.
So He made it available for me. You know, it made my finances, you know, where I was able to do that.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't feel ashamed of that because, you know, I'm a believer. You know?
Yes.
I'm a believer. I'm a giver. You know, I do the things that God required me to do. You know, so for what He do for me, I honor that.
Yes.
You know, but the devil wants you to feel, well, you know, so many people that's out of this, don't have food. And he wants Christians to feel shame of being who we are. And you know, we shouldn't, you know, think low of ourselves in any way. If God is doing wonderful things for you in your life, you know, you should be proud of that. And and really receive that because He wants us to have it.
That's right.
You know.
Okay. That's excellent, excellent. Okay, Sister Hino brought this up, so we'll just try to. It's a pleasure to. Okay, the scripture that Brother Travis read: if God didn't withhold His only begotten Son, but deliver Him up for us all, how shall we not with Him freely? How shall we not with Him freely give us all things?
Yeah.
That means that God has made it possible through the work of Christ. You know, this is the entire, I would call it, revelation, not revelation, but the redemptive work of Christ. God has made all of these blessings possible for us to have them in abundance. As Brother William was saying, there's no limit as to the blessings that God has provided us through Christ. There's no limit. The scripture says all things are ours. So we can go as high up in God's blessings as we want to go, as much as far as our faith and understanding of God's word that we do have. So there's no limit to, God is not limited. The scripture says He has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. So the height of His blessing depends upon us. Our knowledge of the word, our revelation of the word, and our willingness to submit to God's will in obeying Him. See, we've got to have a knowledge of God's word, and then also we have to be willing to what? To obey Him. It's not just a revelation of His word that secures the big blessings, But we have to what? We have to also be in harmony with His Word. So God can't violate His Word to give us freely all things. So there's a knowledge arena. We got to have a revelation. Someone said that the hands of faith cannot reach out and take what the eyes of faith cannot see. Everybody understand that?
Yes.
You can't go out and receive what God has until you have what? Got a revelation of it. An understanding of it. Amen. Through the Word of God. Then, after you get an understanding of it, then you got to what? You got to do what God tells you to do in order for those things to be released into your life. Obedience is a big thing in terms of receiving God's abundance. God's provision. Obedience is a big, big issue. In fact, all of, amen, y'all not gonna like this. All of God's provisions and blessings to the believer is based on his obedience.
Oh, yeah, we do
like it. It's obedience. And sometimes we wonder why, you know, we just, you know, fall behind in so many different areas. Now, Job came to the conclusion, you know, after he had received mercy, after he had prayed for his friends, he was bitter toward his friends, is that right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Bitter toward God. Mm-hmm. He had a whole lot of hostility, anxiety. He was in pain. He was just full of hurts and frustrations and cares.
Yeah.
And the Bible said the Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. Also, the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. Mm-hmm. Oh, he restored twice the number of children, twice the cattle, twice the servants, twice the what, money, I guess twice the wives of them. The Bible says Job's latter end was better than his former end. But Job had to get himself into agreement with God in order for those blessings to be released. And when Job prayed for his friend, when he repented first, when he acknowledged that he had what? Done wrong. And he was no match with God. He had become too big for his britches, so to speak. But when God cooled him down and let him know that he ain't about nothing, and I'm about everything, and you can't contend against me, why are you going to argue against me and accuse me? God asked him 186 questions. He couldn't even answer not a single one. Then Job said, well, I plead the Fifth Amendment. I put my hand on my mouth. I'll shut up. And he went down in sackcloth and repented, got it right. God said, now go pray for your friends. Because you bitter and got a lot of hostility and anxiety. You're mad at them. And I can't release these blessings until you get yourself straight. And when he did that, then what? The Spirit of God began to what? Reverse the situation. Now turn to James 5. It goes along real good with this, I think. It says that James 5:10, take now, brethren, the prophets who have spoken in the name of the Lord for an example of suffering, affliction, and of patience. Behold, we count them happy which endure. Speaking about Job. Ye have heard of the patience of Job, and have seen the end of the Lord, that the Lord is very pitiful and of tender mercy. All right, look at that. And have seen the end of the Lord. In other words, how God actually intervened and treated Job in the end. That's what he was saying. Now just take the example of, ye have heard of the patience of Job, how God treated him after he had actually what? Got things right and really made the atonement. Because Job offered an atonement after he got stuff right. He offered an atonement and his flesh became like the flesh of a child. God just healed his flesh just like that when he offered the atonement. Job said, I found a ransom. He offered that atonement. God told him to offer the atonement after he repented. He offered the atonement, prayed for his friends, and God began to work. His face, his skin became clear as the flesh of a child. And he was just full of sores from the top of crown of his head to the sole of his feet. So this is a good illustration how God will treat you You know, God will never let you down if you make it possible for him to release his what? Mercy and release his compassion. If we just open the door, amen. That's really powerful.
Yeah.
How Job was treated at the end. God is very pitiful and what? Full of compassion. But that still says that we still have to what? Make it possible for God to what? Release these blessings into you. You got to make it possible.
And there are two components that I see in verse 11 there that we have to be possessed with. And that is endurance and patience.
Endurance and patience. Okay, now that's good. Verse 13 is any, now it's switching from Job to us church folk now. All right. It's switching from Job to the church folk now. Is any among you afflicted? Anybody afflicted?
All right.
Now, what do you say, do? Let him pray.
Amen.
Don't stay at home. Pray. Come out and pray. Is any afflicted? Let him what? Pray.
Yeah.
I mean, not these alone two-cent prayers. All right. Is any married? Let him what?
Sing songs.
All right. See, God say, amen, you need to be singing what? Sing in the spirit. Amen. Sing in the spirit. He says, sing. Amen. Now, that's one of the things that hinders the blessing and makes it impossible for God to release his blessings, because many times we are not merry. Somebody say, a merry heart, do it good like a what? How many believe that? A merry heart. Merry heart. Let's get all of our what? Unmarried faces, all unmarried. Let's get rid of them. Let's get shed of them. A merry heart doeth what?
Good.
Like a medicine. If you want to what? Work your way out of whatever you're in, amen, you got to have a what? Merry heart. If you're married, you need to what? Sing. Woo! Sing songs. Amen. That's the reason why all of these scriptures that we're giving you, all of these scriptures can be sang. You know, the Lord is full of compassion. I mean, you can just make up your own song. Just get the scripture, make up your song, and start singing them. It does a whole lot more for you most times when you just what? Trying to read them or meditate on them. All right, let's go. Is any sick among you? Let them do what? Call for the elders of the what? Church, and let them what?
Pray
over him. Doing what?
Anointing him in the name of the Lord.
And the prayer of what? Faith shall what? Save the sick. And the Lord shall what? And if he have committed sins, they shall be what? Alright, so you got to get rid of your sins. Alright, now verse 10, verse 16 says what? Confess your what?
Your faults.
Alright.
Pray for one another
that you may not be what? Alright, confess your what? Faults. See, there are some things that we got to release before God is going to release. Amen. Confess your faults. Amen. I want y'all to forgive me. I haven't paid tithes in 6 months. Somebody said, hey, don't confess that. But I think that, if, you know, by us, yeah, sometimes we just go on like we ain't guilty of nothing, just like Job. I ain't said nothing. I'm holy. Job came to the point where he projected himself as being what, self-righteous. I ain't done nothing wrong. Some things he was not aware of. Because he didn't know spiritual laws had as much impact as what? Natural law. But sometimes people today feel like they can just violate God's laws over and over and over without, you know, paying the consequences.
As the scripture then says, because he does not execute his judgment speedily. And that's how people just continue to get rid of, you know, continue to violate. And you just go on, and it's like, well, nothing's happening.
But I think that sometimes issues, challenges that we have, I think that we need to discuss them with somebody that maybe that's more perfected in those areas. We ought to get with somebody and say, Brother John, you know, I've been having a problem with this for six years. I haven't gotten victory yet. You know, sometimes we are all right in 10 areas, but sometimes one area, we just what, miss it every time. Every time the devil put the squeeze on us, we what? We give in. Amen. How many believe that one, one area you might be weak in, 10 you might be strong in, but how many know that one area can keep the blessings from what? From flowing into your life. And I think that you ought to what? Get with somebody and what? Talk it over. You will find one, you know, somebody that's strong in
that area.
Talk with them. Confess. I mean, I guess y'all trust each other now?
Somebody's not going to spread your business.
You have to be careful who you counsel with.
Right.
Okay, but this is what the parallel between Job. Job had to what? Confess his faults. He had to what? Confess his faults. And this is what God is encouraging us to do. If we want these blessings and these mercies to become reality to us, we're going to have to what? We're going to have to get in line. Hey, but he's acting real good tonight. Y'all bring him every Wednesday. I think he's going to be all right. He's going to be all right. We're entertaining him. He's being entertained. I'm happy. All right, partner. I guess you like us by now, huh? Okay, let's finish that out. Confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that ye may be what? Healed. Yeah. All right, y'all. There, my boy. He's a cutie, ain't he? He's a cutie. Okay. Okay, let's read that 16th verse again, because a whole lot of our healing is going to be in this. Now, y'all wouldn't believe that sometimes things like this keep us from being healed. Things just like this. There's got to be a reason why many believers don't get healed. And so we just want to let you know that God is full of mercy, full of compassion, and he wants to freely give us all things. And it's his good pleasure to give us the kingdom. Healing is a children's bread. All of these powerful scriptures show that God is yearning. He's full of eager yearning. He wants to do it for us real, real bad. But we got to what? Open the door and make it possible for God to do it. He's not going to violate his laws. He's not going to overrule his what? His word to get these blessings into your possession. We're going to have to what? Line up with what God's word. Amen. I don't think that's asking for too much. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be what? Healed. The effectual what? Fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Now, your prayer doesn't become fervent enough to get the results you're seeking until you get all of the obstacles out of the way. When you find people that are real fervent, got a lot of joy, amen, praise God like they're crazy, I mean, you ain't gonna do that unless you got all of the hindrances, because you can't do it. You just can't get that breakthrough. You just can't feel that special anointing. That super duper joy. Just don't experience that boldness until all of the roadblocks are out of the way. Amen. Because the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man does what? Avails much. All right. Praise God. All right. That's about all we're going to have a chance to do tonight. But I want you to take a note of these scriptures. Psalms 145 verse 8. Verses 8, 9, and 10. Just read the whole thing, Psalms 145. And that will begin to get your foundation established for convincing yourself that God is really, really for you. He really wants to bring these blessings in your life in their fullness. And he's just waiting for the opportunity. His eyes are what? Running to and fro.
Amen. Y'all need to have all these scriptures written down. I'm coming around and see what y'all got written down. Amen. Y'all put it out. Look what y'all got written down. All right, Psalms 145. Amen. Tonight we did Psalms 103, verse 11, 12, 13. Romans 8:32. And I think Sunday we did 2 Chronicles 16 and 9, is that right?
Yeah.
And we had Psalms 35, 27. He had pleasure in the prosperity of his saints. Amen. He delighteth in mercy. Michael 7:18. Woo, glory. Luke 12:32 is the Father's good pleasure. Luke 12:32. Y'all don't have this one. Luke 12:32 is the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Woo, glory. Now, these are the type of scriptures that you need to be saying when you're in prayer. Say them. It's God's good pleasure. Ooh, kala my son to give me the kingdom.
Pastor.
Yes, ma'am.
I know we got about 3 more minutes. I'll make it real quick. You mentioned earlier about all of our blessings are contingent upon the obedience. Mm-hmm. I'd like to add one other thing there, too. Mm-hmm. And that would be wisdom. Mm-hmm. Thinking about Ecclesiastes, Solomon, who was the wisest man that ever lived under the old covenant. Mm-hmm. And he had everything. And we can draw a contemporary example to that. Mm-hmm. Solomon, yes. Wives, concubines, horses, the best of horses, orchards, everything. And then he said, and I mean, keep in mind he was a wise man. But in Ecclesiastes he says, let us hear the conclusion of the matter. Okay, it is fear God of the whole man. Mm-hmm. Fear God and keep his commandments. Mm-hmm. So this is the whole duty of man. In other words, here's a man who's experienced all of this and who was wise. Mm-hmm. But in his wisdom, he said, so along with obedience, we have to have wisdom because sometimes God has given us all of this. Mm-hmm. Look what he gave Solomon. That didn't satisfy. And sometimes people have had all those things and they've lost it, but do they exercise wisdom?
Right.
But even if they've lost it all, he is saying that the whole, just fear God and keep his commandment, regardless of all this stuff.
Right.
You know, fear God and keep his commandment.
All right, fearing God is a wholesome dread of displeasing him. Amen. If a person really, it just hurts them to violate God's word. A wholesome dread is almost, it's scary. And you do everything you can to keep from what displeasing God. So that's what fear of the Lord is all about. All right? So the lessons that we are having now is designed to get our faith rooted and grounded in God's goodness. And once we can do that, then we'll understand what we got to do in order for us to make it possible for God's goodness to be released into our lives. Amen. So that's about it for tonight. God bless you. Meditation.